All right. Okay. Good evening, everyone. I am B. Jagadishwar Reddy, IPS 2017 batch, scored 206 in interview in 2017. Right. Today, I will be discussing about the tips that you can follow for interview, or rather than tips, I would say it as the approach that you can adopt to score well in your interview. First of all, I would suggest whoever, if you are watching this video or whenever you watch this video, that to keep UPSC notification in front of you, and in that particular notification, I would request you to go to the page which talks about the syllabus of the interview, similar to the prelims, mains and interview test, right? Now, that if you come to this one, that is interview test, first look at this, what the examiner or what the UPSC is expecting from you. Just look at the paper that you have in front of you. It says the candidate will be interviewed by a board who will have before them a record of his career. He will be asked, right, before I proceed further, I will first read out the entire thing, and then I would be explaining each and every sentence of this one, each and every word rather of this, so that you understand it thoroughly. All right. Now, he will be asked questions on matters of general interest. The object of the interview is to assess the personal suitability of the candidate for a career in public service by a board of competent and unbiased observers. Understand this, competent and unbiased observers. The test is intended to judge the mental caliber of a candidate. In broad terms, this is really an assessment of not only his intellectual qualities, but also social traits and his interest in current affairs. Some of the qualities to be judged are mental alertness, critical powers of assimilation, clear and logical exposition, balance of judgment, variety and depth of interest, ability for social cohesion, and leadership and intellectual or moral integrity. Right, that is the first point. And the second point says, the technique of the interview is not that of a strict cross-examination, but of a natural, though directed, purposive conversation, which is intended to reveal the mental qualities of a candidate. The interview test is not intended to be a test of either the specialized knowledge or general knowledge of the candidate, which has already been tested through your written exams, that is mains, which contains 7 papers. Candidates are expected to have taken an intelligent interest not only in their area of interest, but also not only in the area subjects of academic study, but also in the events which are happening around them, both within and outside their own state and country, as well as in modern current of thought and in new discoveries which should rouse the curiosity of a well-educated youth, right? That is what the syllabus says, that's the UPSC notification says. Now let's come to this one, right? Now how I would structure this is like this. First, I will explain each and every aspect of this one, that is the entire thing that is there in the syllabus. Then I would give you some examples as to how you can deal with some questions in the interview. Then I would give you my experience, that is, I appeared for interview in civil service 2015, that is 2016 interview, in which I scored 150, and then in the interview 2017, in which I scored 206. What was the difference then and what was the difference now? I mean, what is the status now? How did it become to that, you know, how did I transform that 150 to 200, whatever I have done in that one? This is what I will be expecting. Towards the end of it, I will give you some general guidelines as a rule, probably which you can adopt to get a decent score in interview, right? And before I start this one, I will tell you one thing. Please do not expect that by watching this video, you are going to get 200 in the interview. As simple as that one, it's not going to happen that way. However, I can say with some reasonable certainty that if you can follow what I am trying to, you know, convey it to you and it understand properly, I am sure you will get more than average marks, which is sufficient for you to get into a good service, right? Now, the first one, let's talk about this one. Before moving further, I will explain the general setup in the interview. The general setup is like this. You will be having five interviewers. Out of that, there will be one person who is called as the chairman of the board, and that in the other four people will be from different streams. And the chairman of the board is invariably UPSC member. And you all know about that, how many members are there in UPSC and all. So that chairman has the final authority. So he will be the one who will be generally starting the interview and concluding the interview. The other four people are there to ask questions from various streams. That's how it works. And then once chairman starts off, he will be passing on to the different people to ask me the questions, and then accordingly they will be asking. However, each person will be asking from questions from a different area, or even if two people are asking from same area, they will make sure that all the things from your entire biodata or from your career will be touched upon. That is what they will be doing. That's how it generally works. And towards the end of it, again chairman takes it over. Chairman will ask a couple of questions if he has anything in his mind, in his or her mind, and then the interview is over. This is what the process is. And secondly, so though people say there is some amount of subjectivity, yes, I do agree there is amount of subjectivity in this one. However, there is no bias towards any particular person. Let me tell you, even before, just our half an hour before the interview, or maybe around 15 minutes before the interview board chairman, he himself will get to know who are the candidates that he or she will be interviewing, because it is done through a lottery system, apparently. This is what, but however, there it is unbiased, so you need not worry about that one. Now, moving on to this one, now let's look at this. The candidate will be interviewed by a board who will have before them a record of his career. Record of his career, by this, it is meant, what they are trying to tell you is that they will be having your DAF. As simple as that one. Now, people ask me often, sir, what will they be having? Will they be having a summary of our DAF or the DAF itself? Some people look at summary, but some people look at DAF. Eventually, they will be having the entire DAF in front of them. If they want, at any point of time, they can take the DAF and then ask you questions from there. So, there is nothing stopping you from understanding this way. They will be having your DAF. That's the final thing. Next, he will be asked questions on matters of general interest. If you understand this, it is simply saying that you will be asked questions on matters of general interest. How does a general interest matter? You know, how can you define general interest? When you are saying that it is general interest differs from different people, right? My general interest will be different and your general interest will be different. If you talk, let's say there is another person who is working in, let's say corporate sector, his general interest will be different. However, here we are appearing for an interview which is for civil services. So, the general interest for a civil services career is what the examiner is trying to tell you here. Rather, UPSC notification is trying to tell you that. So, the general interest for a civil servant would be the developments in the country and all the other stuff probably that you have seen in your GS mains. That's the thing. Next, you move on. The object of the interview is to assess the personal suitability of the candidate for a career in public services by a board of competent and unbiased observers. As I told you in the beginning, look at these two, competent and unbiased. Underline these two. Why I say this is competent and unbiased? First, let me explain competent. What exactly do we mean by competent is this? Understand it this way simply. Most of them would be either retired professors or professors who are nearing retirement. So that makes it around 60 years of age roughly. So that is what, if we assume that there is around 60 years. And there are 5 people. So total experience of them is around 300 years. And maybe most of you who are appearing in for the interview, maybe in early 20s or probably late 20s, very few with 30 plus, which means that it is eventually a person with knowledge of 30 years with versus the knowledge of 300 years. That is what is meant by competence. This should also tell you that in terms of knowledge, we are not going to beat them. And in addition to this, just not the experience, in addition to this, you need to understand that at any point of time, should they choose, they can access internet and then come across any knowledgeable point, which means that knowledge wise, they are far more superior and you are at the end of it one. So the knowledge is not what they are trying to tell you here. That is what is meant by competent. And also, just not this one, you can also look at competence in another way, that they are experts in their own fields. Whatever, whether they are professors or they are corporate people or they are people from academic background or into the civil services itself or in social sector like NGOs and all, they are experts. So they have the depth of knowledge. That is what it means. Then it's unbiased. What do you mean by unbiased? We have already learned this, right? Neutrality, bias and all this in GS4 paper as well. Maybe to some extent we would have read it in polity as also, right? Which means the unbiasedness is that they are not favoring or disfavoring anyone. As I told you a couple of minutes back, even they do not know whom they are interviewing at least up to 10-15 minutes before the interview as well. So even if a person has very, you know, even if you assume that a person is son or daughter of a bureaucrat, but still he or she has very little chance, almost negligible chance of influence in the interview. That is what it is. Now, if you understand it this way, it is to assess the personal suitability, and that board, which is competent and unbiased, is trying to test whether you are personally suitable or not. By personal suitability, what they is trying to tell you is that, let's take, you know, if you take the services of IPS or IAS or IFS, that is foreign service, or revenue service, what is the qualities of these, you know, what are the characteristic or qualities or the skills that these jobs demand? One thing that you can understand that you have to work for long hours, or you should have some keen interest in, you know, what is happening into the country, how the development is taking place, what is the law and order situation, you know, how this income tax or commercial direct and indirect taxes are being, you know, whether it is sufficient or not sufficient. These are the things that you need to look at it, whether you are personally suitable for these kind of jobs or not. This is what they are trying to test you. If you ask me, sir, how can you say that, what is the question that tests my personal suitability? It is not a question, one single question that will determine what is your personal suitability, whether you are suitable to the job or not. It is a set of questions, and also the reaction to those questions that will actually determine whether you are suitable for that particular job or not. This is what it is. Right, and glass water, pani. I will continue. Okay. Now, let's move to the next one. What is the next one here? The test is intended to judge the mental caliber of a candidate. When you look at this one, the test is intended to the mental caliber. You know what is caliber and what is mental. So, if you combine that mental caliber of a candidate, see, what is the mental capacity of this particular person? Mental capacity, it doesn't only mean it's intellectual capacity, right? It's also the capacity to understand and capacity to comprehend a particular situation. So, that is what they are trying to test you. To test this mental capacity, there are various ways that they can do. They can give you a situation and then try to understand what is your reaction, and they can ask you an intellectual question, and they can give you a law and order scenario or a disaster scenario and then ask you to ask for your response and so on. All of this, your, especially your response, the way you respond, it's not the response itself, but the way you respond will actually determine your mental caliber, how you are responding, what are the various things you are, you know, putting into your calculations before arriving at the response. That is what matters for this particular thing, right? Then moving on further, in broad terms, this is really an assessment of not only his intellectual qualities, but also social traits and his interest in current affairs. All right. See, it is said not only intellectual qualities, which means intellectual qualities are being tested. So, in interview, they might test your intellectual qualities also, but besides that, it goes further in saying that social traits and his interest in current affairs. It is clearly stated in this intro, you know, syllabus itself, that you will be asked questions on current affairs. When it is already stated that it is, you know, asked on current affairs, it is nothing but obvious that you have to be going through these current affairs, especially the maybe around 2 to 3 months before your interview, the total current affairs, whatever is being happening in the country or outside the country maybe. And look at the other term that is there, social traits. What do you understand by the social traits? Just think for a moment. There is no definition as such for this one, but social traits is what? Being social, or, you know, you are interacting with other people. How do you interact with other people? What is your response when you are interacting with the other people? To explain this better, let me give you an example. Let us say, whether you are a district collector or SP, one person who is in trouble, let us say a person whose chain has been snatched, or let's say there is a girl who has been molested by a group of people. Now, if she comes to you and complains, then what do you think your social quality should be, or what do you think your reaction should be? You must obviously be, you know, talking properly to her, and then in a way that consoles her, and then at the end it assures her that it will not happen further, and most importantly, the people who have molested, the perpetrators, will be taken to task. how do you convey all this to that particular girl who has been molested? That is what your social traits come in. How do you handle that situation? How do you talk to her? And how do you take the complaint and so on? This is what is a social trait. Or for instance, if you take, you are in a district collector, and a person comes to you, or the people come to you, a group of villagers come to you, and then give you an application that there is no proper road, that's pakka road in their village. That, when they are coming to you, you should be approachable to them. You should be approachable and you should be friendly to them. That is what is a social trait they are asking you for. You cannot be very serious to them, right? Now, whenever I am saying that you have to be approachable and that you should not be serious and so on, I am not trying to tell you that keep on laughing when you are, facing with these situations and all. But be pleasant, that is what I would say. Don't, we were also preparing for interview, one person has clearly, but I still remember what he has said. One faculty member had told me that, don't keep your face as if you have come to a funeral, or someone has died and you are, there to complete the last rites, right? You understand what I mean? That should be avoided completely. We are not there, I know it is a serious situation and it is one of the important situations in our lives, no doubt about that. But that doesn't mean that you have, become so serious that the other person is not comfortable, talking to you. That is what is a social trait, right? And that is what you have to understand. That is what this particular thing is saying. See, if you look at this, you may think that, sir, is this exactly how it is working? Isn't there any, other opinions to this one? Maybe. But as I already told you, I am trying to tell you from my perspective and trying to analyze it objectively without getting any subjectivity into this one. I am just trying to explain what is this, these things mean and how do you handle that. That differs from individual to individual. I handle it in a different way. You might handle it in a different way. The third person might be having a completely altogether different way. That is what you need to understand. Right, that brings us further. Now, he has given that one key: intellectual quality, social traits, and in interest in current affairs. Now, then he is talking about this. Some of the qualities to be judged are mental alertness, critical powers of assimilation, clear and logical exposition, balance of judgment, variety and depth of interest, ability for social cohesion, and leadership, intellectual and moral integrity. See, I can say, if there is any one sentence that sums up your interview syllabus, it is this sentence. What are they going to test? First, mental alertness. What exactly do you mean by mental alertness? Let's say, suppose you are being interviewed, or if I am taking the interview, the interviewer might ask questions like ABCD. Questions ABCD has asked. If you are not mentally alert, what will happen is that either of the things can happen. Firstly, you might completely forget one or two questions that she has given you. So that is one problem. And secondly, even if the interviewer is asking one question, only one question, let's say the bigger one, you might miss parts of that particular question. Some of the important information within that the question had contained, you might miss it altogether. That is what is mental alertness. You should be alert to what the examiner is asking you. Only when you are alert to what the examiner is asking you, will you be able to answer all the questions correctly, and also not just correctly but also in a manner that is that the interviewers are expecting. This is what I meant by mental alertness. And also the other thing, I can also take another example. So this the example that I am going to give you, take it with a pinch of salt, so people have a different opinion, but my opinion is like this. Let us say that if the interviewer asks you, see, there is a landslide that had happened, or let's say there is a simple thing we will take. There is a fire accident that has happened in your locality or in your district. What will you do? That's it. This is what the question is. The fire accident has happened. What will you do? Now, in mental alertness, I would say personally, if I was to be asked this question, I would first ask, sir, what is my position? Am I a common citizen? Or am I a revenue authority? Or am I police? Or am I just just like normal citizen, as a bystander? Depending on what your role is or what your position is, your response will be different. If you are an authority, if you are a police authority, you are the first person who has to respond to this one, and your response will be much more. If you are a commoner, maybe you can, the first duty for you to is to call to the fire ambulance or this you know, this ambulance system, and they inform the police and the local authorities, other authorities. Same is the case with revenue authorities. If you are an employee, it is your immediate task is to make sure that the government machinery arrives and so on, arrives at the, you know, scene of accident, and then do the things that are needful. This is what is mental alertness. If you understand that, you know, if you assume that accident has happened, you assume that you are the district collector and then take it, or your district SP and then move forward, that will not look good. If at all you are assuming, then tell the interviewer that, sir, assuming that I am so and so, let's say I am the district SP or collector or whatever, or the revenue authority and so on, I will do this one. That will give more clarity. This is what my opinion, as I already told you before, people may not agree on this one. Quite a few of my friends also have had a different opinion on this one. That's fine. People have different opinions. But still, I would say this is more logical way of putting it. Because you are not asking for more information, it's just one word thing. You are not trying to extract information from interviewer, which they may not appreciate. That's the first thing. Secondly, you are looking at critical powers of assimilation. When you say critical powers of assimilation, what does it comes to your mind? Just this word critical is bothering us, you know, it must be bothering you since your prelims, maybe not exactly in prelims, maybe in mains, especially in paper 2 and paper 3. You must have been, you know, banging your head as to what is this critically analyze, you know, criticize and all this stuff. That critical powers of assimilation. Assimilation, you know, what does it mean? Taking the knowledge in. But when you are taking the knowledge in, you must be critical of whatever is coming into the, whatever is going into your mind and what the opinion that you are forming. See, you need to understand that anything and everything that you are reading in newspapers or then, you know, looking at and listening to your friends or in the media need not be correct. They have their own biases and they have their own filters. And obviously the information is distorted when it is coming from source to source. And they have their own vested interests as well. So you need to take every knowledge with a pinch of salt, unless until it is a fact. A fact, you know, there is a particular thing, let's say there's a simple thing. ABC has taken over this particular company, or ABC is the present in charge of this particular company. That is a fact. There is no opinion, whether you say or I say, everyone has to say the same. But a particular person is very moody, or he will not respond to a group of people, whoever is approaching him. That is an opinion that you are forming based on whatever sources, your personal experience, or you are listening from your friends and so on. This is where you need to be critical. That critical was this one. You need to understand, you need to confirm it, you need to, you know, question that whatever theory that you have with the counter product, you know, with the counter argument. Now, that's what I always say. For every argument, try to develop a counter argument. And this will help not only in your interview, but in general in your mains as well. Everywhere it will help you to make sure that the opinion that you are forming will stand the test of reason. So that is what you need to understand. That is critical powers of assimilation. Next comes to this one, clear and logical exposition. The first word doesn't need any explanation. Exposition means a comprehensive idea. I'm just giving you the dictionary definition. A comprehensive idea about a theory or a particular process. That is what is exposition means. So your understanding must be comprehensive. That means it should not be superficial. Let's say what is, you are looking at, having worked in the banking industry, I will take the example of this NPS, non-performing assets. If you take that way, even a 10th standard kid will know that NPA means non-performing assets and SBA has so much and this one. So may not be 10th standard kid, but let's say a normal 12th standard or graduation student. But then going to the civil services interview, and maybe in future you might be in for IRS or IAS or IPS, wherein you will be one way or the other, you will have some influence on these ones. You are expected to know more. That is what is comprehensive. Why did they originate and what are the reasons, why it had become such a big problem and so on. This is what is crucial to us. It is not just that, you know, the taking the facts and then, you know, vomiting it in the interview or just, just putting it in the paper. It is that comprehensive idea. Where is it coming from? You know, what are the solutions? What has the government has done so far? These are the things that we need to be concentrating on. That is clear and that is, you know, exposition. Even that exposition must be clear. By clear, I mean, whatever you are saying, the interviewer must be able to understand, right? See, let's say, I have a simple thing. If I define like this, whatever we are going to see, the last 10 seconds, whatever I spoke normally, I spoke the same sentences that I was speaking before, but it was very fast. Even that, you would have realized that, right? Maybe 3-4 words. Even that will have an impact on what you are trying to say. The examiner may not be able to understand what you are trying to say. Therefore, a bit clear. Clear, I have put it literally. It will, if you take it, you know, in terms of this context, you can also take it like this. Your understanding has to be clear. If you are explaining one particular thing, A leads to B, B leads to C, C leads to D. That is how it should be. A is finally leading to D. I am just taking a very vague example. A is finally leading to D, but what is the relation between B and C, or what is, how is A to D is related? If you don't know that, it becomes a problem. That is what is clear exposition, right? Then logical. What do you mean by logical? I will give you a simple example, okay? You know, one of my friends, I think in 2012 interview, 2013 interview, so there was a question about, I think about Narega. So the question was about, initially he spoke Narega, whether it is required or not, or how much money government has to spend and so on. His initial point was that government should spend more on Narega. So that had happened, so everything was going smooth. As the interview progressed, the discussion went on about development and so on, then it drifted towards urban development. When it became to urban development, then it so happened that we are increasing our urbanization, and maybe next 10-15 years down the line, our urban population may be much more than the rural population. So you need more facilities in urban area, the number of people in rural areas are going to be lesser. Now there is a, then it came that we should be spending more on urbanization than on rural thing, whatever that we are trying to do. Now understand here, there is a logical contradiction, I mean, there is a contradiction in what he has said. Initially you spend more on Narega, so which means that rural employment guarantee, you are spending more on that one. And on the other hand, you are trying to say that spend more on urbanization. You can say he or she could have said that, you know, there should be a balance. But he said initially that no, there has to be more focus on Narega. But at the end, he is saying that there has to be more focus on urbanization. This is a contradiction. It is not logical. And if it isn't logical, be rest assured that the interviewers will be able to catch that out. You might say, sir, that has happened 5 minutes back. How will they be remembering this one? See, it is we who are under tension facing the interview. They are not under pressure to, you know, interview us. They have been doing this, you know, for the past n number of years, and they will continue to do so. Therefore, they will be very critical of this one, what you are trying to tell you. I hope you are able to understand what I am trying to say. That is what. Now, moving further. Balance of judgment. I think ethics 4 paper, and then, you know, ethics paper, GS4, that is GS2 in this polity paper. Everyone would have seen your conclusion must be balanced and so on. So, therefore, I don't want to dwell more on this one as to what is your balance of judgment. But I would say only one thing, that whenever you are arriving at a conclusion, please make sure that it is not any of the extremes. But whenever I say that it is any of the extremes, quite a few people ask me, sir, does that mean that we should not be, you know, we should not be giving our opinion clearly? No, that shows your indecisiveness. You should be clear, a particular decision is taken, this is what is my opinion, and just say that opinion. That is done. However, when you are saying the opinion, that particular opinion should not be either of the extremes. It's, let's say, a simple thing. If you say there is a communal clash, you cannot, you know, if there are two people, you know, it's almost becoming difficult for you to control and all, you cannot say directly, you know, shoot two people from this side and two people from that side, they will stop and so on. That is the extreme step, right? That is what is avoided. That action must be maybe decisive, but you're not doing anything. At the same time, suppose in the same scenario you say that do nothing and just, you know, idle, because you cannot go to either of the extremes. Sir, I will just wait, you know, I will just give some warnings and all, I will just wait. That shows your indecisiveness. Because even if you don't do anything, there will be some sort of violence there, and, you know, that might threaten, you know, life and property of the people. That is what is balance of judgment. Whatever you are saying, use, you know, some balance, whatever you're trying to do. It's not just in action, but also arriving at an opinion. Whenever you are talking about an issue, whether whatever has happened, whether governor's rule in a particular state is good or bad, whether the appointment of, you know, some particular public authority is good or bad, was there any issue in that one? In all these cases, come at a conclusion absolutely that is necessary, come at a conclusion, but have that balance. Why and how you are arriving at that matters more. And next comes what? Ability for social cohesion. Sorry, and before that, I think variety and depth of interest. Variety and depth of interest, you already know. See, when we are saying that it is variety and depth of interest, variety means you know. That means you should not be only academic oriented, right? This variety and variety of interest comes from your own DAF. Your DAF tells you, they are asking you in your DAF, what is your extracurricular activities, co-curricular activities and leadership skills and so on. This shows the versatility and the diversity of a particular person, and that is what is necessary. And that is why you say, some people saying that, sir, my all questions had come from DAF only. For some person they might say, sir, none of the questions were from DAF. It will never be the case that no question was from DAF. They may not ask you a particular, by taking a particular, point in your DAF. However, I am sure that they will be touching upon the points that you are, that your career was related to. That's for sure that is going to happen. Understand that. Just remember that, a bit thoroughly. And depth of interest. What do you mean by depth of interest is this one. When you are looking for, let's say you say that, I have been my district level player of cricket or district level player of whatever, kabaddi and so on. What is your interest into that one? Or let's say a simple thing, I will take even more, a simple thing. Watching tennis, you will say. The depth of interest tells you that watching tennis is fine. It's okay, so you are just watching the match. A played B and then A won by so and so. That's fine. But where did they play? What are, different types of tennis courts that you have? Who are the players and what are the skills? Do we have any, tennis infrastructure in India? Why is India not doing so good in tennis compared to other sports? Why are we doing well in badminton if you were to be a badminton fan? And that too, if you see, most of the female players are coming up in India as far as badminton is concerned. Male players, though there are some good players, but they are not as dominant as female players, the other two female players are. Why is this happening? This is what indicates to the examiner your depth of interest. You have to understand that. See, when I say this one, I think in one of the seminars that I was taking, a couple of people asked me, so what is the depth, what is the, level to which the depth we should, plunge ourselves to? There is a line in that one, right? Now then, just because we are asking about depth, you need not worry about, how much has government allocated to badminton. Where are they constructing the stadiums and so on. That is absolutely not necessary. You need to have an analytical view, but not, too much of factual knowledge. That's not required. Next, ability for social cohesion and leadership. What is social cohesion? Social, I already, that's being mingling with other people and so on. Cohesion means keeping things together, taking everyone along. So social cohesion, whatever decision that you are taking and whatever the words that you are using as a civil servant or as a public servant, all of them should make sure that they are helping in integration of society, not disintegration. This is what is crucial and this is what social cohesion means. For instance, if there is a clash, the previous example that I was giving you, communal clash, the action that you take should be in such a way that people of both the communities are able to gel together and then live together. It should not be in such a way that it is creating a chasm between those two and then they are not able to, pursue their ordinary, life activities. This is where you need to be critical and this is where you need to be, very cautious around. So that is what is your cohesion, social cohesion. And leadership, I need not say about this one, you must have read a lot of material on this one, leadership it shows. And then intellectual and moral integrity. I think the entire, I think we have a complete syllabus kind of thing on this one in GS4. So let me not dwell more upon that one. However, one intellectual and moral integrity, I would say, whatever you are talking in terms of in your intellectual kind of thing, your future actions should also be in accordance, in consonance with what you have already spoken. For instance, you say that, let us say, a simple example I will give you. Let's say a district collector says that in his or her district, the roads are very bad and the immediate requirement is for roads, that, you know, so some budget has to be allocated. However, when the funds come, he or she allocates some more to something else, assuming that all situations remain, you know, all the circumstances remain same and no external force is there. That's an ideal scenario we are considering just for your, you know, understanding purpose. Everything remaining same, he or she said that the roads are the, you know, the most important things, we have to do that, but then suddenly you are deviating from your own things. Assuming that everything is same, this is what I have always told you, no pressures, nothing, there is a contradiction in that one. That is what you need to guard against, right? Your actions should also be in consonance with what you are trying to tell you. This is a very trivial example, I know, but I have just given you to make sure that you understand the tough. Don't take this particular example. So this will be very horrible for you to defend in the interview, if at all you are taking it. Right, so that is what finishes off our first point. Then comes the second point. The technique of the interview is not that of a strict cross-examination. So the interviewers are not trying to question you on everything that you are trying to tell them. So whatever you tell them, they are not trying to question you that. But understand, it's not a cross-examination, agreed, but natural, though directed and purposive conversation. Understand these two, directed and purposive. They have a purpose. They have a purpose, that's why they were, you know, pushing you towards something. This is why, you know, some people always say, so the interviewer was always asking me a question on this one because he had a purpose there. You did not serve that purpose till that particular point, so he kept on pushing you to that thing. That is where you need to be careful of. If you can understand this, then at least in your mind, you will be much more calmer. And then this is directed conversation. So that they will be, you know, going through such conversation. You must have heard from your friends or other people that I did not understand what they were doing. Some random questions they were asking you, fine enough. See, you may not understand what is the purpose or how they were directing you. But always remember that example that I already told you in the beginning, it is 30 years versus 300 years. 300 years of experience will obviously understand things better than 30 years of experience. So always keep this thing in mind, that will give you some peace of mind. Right, next. Again, that conversation which is intended to reveal the mental qualities of the candidate. Again, it goes back to the previous thing, it is trying to test your mental qualities of the candidate. What are the mental qualities? He has already given. Ability for social cohesion, critical assimilation of knowledge, your intellectual skills, your ability for communication and all this stuff. And one thing that I forgot, clear and logical exposition. People always say that why you need to be conversing in, you know, good, so that the other person understands. That is the essence of communication, right? The essence of communication is using simple words, but make sure that the other person understands what you are trying to tell him or her. For simple thing, whatever I am trying to tell you, I am using very simple English. You know, sometimes I am using some Hindi terms also, that's fine enough, as long as you are able to understand this. That is the reason, if you understand, some of us may not be well conversant, or some of us may not be so good in English or Hindi, which are the two, you know, the modes of the people who are, you know, giving interview, maximum number of people. They have also given us the option of giving in the interview in your mother tongue. All the regional languages that you can have, be it, you know, Bengali, Telugu, Kannada, Tamil, Malayal, Gujarati, whatever it is, in every language you can give your interview. It is because, they believe that the UPSC, the philosophy is that you may not be putting yourself clearly in a particular language, or let's say English, that doesn't mean that your knowledge is or your communication skill itself is bad. In English, yes, it is not as good as your other language, but in your mother tongue, you are as good, maybe better than other people when they are conversing it in English or Hindi, right? This is what you have to understand. I think this should also answer your questions about what the doubts that you have, sir, what if I am not good in English and so on. That's fine enough. Who is asking you for good English? No one is asking for good English. They are asking for good communication. They are asking you for good level of knowledge and then the way you are communicating. That's what matters ultimately. And the next one, I think that is what the second point is. Let's come to the third one. The interview test is not intended to be a test either of the specialized or general knowledge of the candidate. Specialized or general knowledge of the candidate, I already told you. Specialized knowledge means what? A particular specific knowledge about a topic. If you take, let's say, you are an electrical engineer. So in an electrical engineer, whatever, you know, whichever stream that you are in, when you are talking about this, the things that are being operated by electricity, if the questions are on that one, the specific working of a particular machine and so on, you may be aware or you may not be aware of that one. They may test that as well, but it's very rare, because it has already said that which has already been tested through their written papers. Your electrical engineering skills are already tested in your electrical engineering exam, that is in your optional paper, and they are not interested to test that again. It is because you have cleared and fared well in your optional, you are sitting in front of them. What is the point in again testing you on the same things? Understand it logically. If you were to interview, will you test the same or you will try to test something else? If I were to be there, or any logical person would say that he or she will be testing something else, which apart from what has already been tested in your mains. This is what is crucial now. So that means, next he is explaining that it is not a test of special or general knowledge, but candidates are expected to have taken an intelligent interest. Intelligent interest. I think I already put interest there, and intelligent interest means some sort of analysis, some sort of critical thinking into that. Into what? Not only in their special subjects of academic study, whatever is graduation, post-graduation, whatever it is, but also in the events which are happening around them. So your intelligent interest should not be confined only to your optional or only to your GS papers and so on, but it should also be to be the events that are happening around you. So let's say, just I am taking a random example, very simple example. Let's say before you go to the interview, on your interview, just let's say 10 days before, in your region, your state CM or the PM has announced a development work of, let's say, around 1000 crores. It does not fall into any of our syllabus, that's for sure, but you should have taken some interest into that one. Now, what is intelligent interest? Interest is knowing that CM or PM has allocated 1000 crores, fine enough. What is intelligent interest? For what purpose has it been allocated? And what is the duration of that particular activity? Why has it been allocated? And how many people will be benefited by that? This is what is intelligent interest for the events happening around you, right? Around you, that is both within and outside their own state or country. This is what is crucial. I think this gives us more or less everything what you have to study. Intelligent interest in the events happening both within and outside your own state and country. Let's say last week, I think this week only, there was a Naxal attack on the security forces. I think some CRPF jawans were martyred in that one. It happened in Chhattisgarh. So if you are from Chhattisgarh, you are expected to know that a bit in detail. If you are from other state, still you are expected to know, but may not be in as much detail as the other person from Chhattisgarh is expected to. That is what you have to understand. Again, it is an intelligent interest. It's not how many people were died, okay, this is what has happened and so on. That is factual. You need analytical. Why did it happen? What were they doing there? And what was their protocol? That's it. Nothing more than that one. What is their SOP? What are they patrolling and so on? That is not your area of concern, right? That's what it is. Similarly with the country as well. Our Prime Minister is touring different countries. So and so on. I would say for the events that are happening outside the country, give as much importance as you are giving for your international relations, international relations portion in your paper too. First, more focus on neighbors. Next, more focus on the super global powers, and then the peripheral things, nothing more than that. Last, the one outside country, intelligent interest in that. Apart from that, in modern currents of thought and in new discoveries which should rouse the curiosity of well-educated youth. New currents of thought. So now one example I will give you, new currents of thought. Recently there was a term that was that gained currency, that benevolent capitalism. This is a modern current, current of thought that is running in the world right now. So whether you take Facebook, one other is Mark Zuckerberg or Infosys, Dr. Narayana Murthy, and these people, or Wipro chairman Ajim Premji, who are giving their wealth for the sake of, they are using it for the benefit of the society. There are various ways this benevolent capitalism is manifesting, right? How they are using it and so on. You should be aware of that one. See, it is still in nascent stages, I do agree, so there cannot be any concrete definition of this one, that's fine. But you still need to understand, how did it come about and what are people thinking about it and what will be its future is going to be, at least some opinion on that one. That is what they are expecting on, because it might catch the, you know, it might catch the imagination of the public in the next 10 to 20 years, and that's how the state's, you know, the country's future will be shaped. We must be aware of that. And also new discoveries, any sort of new discoveries, you know, whether especially if it is in our country, any new monuments have been discovered, you know, what was the historical importance of that one, or any new planets or galaxies, whatever they are discovering, you should be aware of that. As far as this is concerned, you need not go deep into this one, especially the last part of this modern currents of thought, and then new discoveries. You just need to be aware of the factual things and just one or two lines of analysis. That's it, nothing more than that. Okay, so that concludes what we are listed for today's as the syllabus of interview. Okay, it's 5 minutes. Continue. Okay, just. So now I would move to give about what. Now I will tell you what we need to be thinking about. Right. Firstly, if you look at this one, so one question that everyone asks me as far as this one, why civil services? So everyone say, some people honestly say, sir, that I want power and that status, so I want the civil services and so on. Fine enough, that on the face of it, that is what maybe most of you are interested in. There is much more to that, like public service, the responsibility that you get, the respect you are going to get in the society, and the way you can contribute to the society and so on. I would put it this way. When we were preparing for IIM interviews, see, it's not directly related to the question as such, but it is the theory is common here. I will tell you, put it this way. So when we were preparing for IIM interviews, so one of the faculty members asked me, why do you want to do an MBA? So our answer was simple, that sir, we want money, we want lots of money, so that's why we are preparing for MBAs. That is what our answer is, but obviously that cannot be the case. But then we said, sir, nothing else is coming to our mind, what should we do? So obviously you can have other answers, that so on and so on, but frankly this was the answer that we had. Then he gave us one scenario. Let us say a company is paying you 1 crore rupees per annum, and then your duty is to sit in the room like this, let's say such a room as big as this one, and then there are some 10 20 bricks. Every day you have to come and sit in the room and then count those bricks. You have to count it, let's say 20 30 times every day. That's it, nothing else, no other work. They are giving you 1 crore. Just imagine, will you be able to do that for next 30 years? Just think about it. That's what he had told us. I will tell you the same thing. People give you only that everyone is saluting you, or everyone is praising you and so on, and then you have that power. That will not drive you for long. Maybe you might get kick out of it, let's say some 1 year 2 years, but then then you will think about other things as to what else need to be done. Simple as that. Again, you have to think to come to the answer for this one. That is why each answer why civil services will be different from the other. If I have one answer, you might be having other answer, right? Understand this thoroughly. This is extremely crucial. Always remember that example, why civil service, if you are always thinking about power and the status. Of course, that comes with civil services, come that might come, but that will not be the only thing that you are expected to have, right? So that is one thing. So how this one is, this is the important question. Now moving on, the last part of what I had told you in the beginning, that is my experience, why did I get that 150 and so on. Now see, in the first interview when I appeared in the year 2016, I had gone through this syllabus as such. It's not that I didn't go through this one, I did go through. I had reasonable knowledge about that. But I did not understand each and everything as much as I understand it now, as much as I am explaining it to you. So my thought process was that, okay, we need more knowledge. They can ask anything in the interview. So if they are asking anything, we need to know more things and many more things, fine enough. But then as you spread your knowledge more, if you are concentrating as in more breadth and breadth, the depth becomes shallower and shallower. It becomes more shallower. So if they push you to some limit, you have no defense because you have not thought through particular things. That is where the problem occurred. I was concentrating more on having that kind of more knowledge and so on. but I failed to understand that, you know, rather I did not fail to understand, but I failed to focus upon this particular aspect, that this is also crucial. And by then, you know, when I came out of the interview, it was already late, that it was already over, so nothing can be done, because interview doesn't give you a second chance. Once it is done, it's done. And also, secondly, you need to understand, with this experience, so let me continue with this one first. So with this experience, what I did, that I realized it's not about knowledge, it's about all the aspects that I told you, you know, this and so on. So then I started analyzing how the response should be, rather than the response itself. How you are arriving at a particular answer rather than the answer itself matters more in any interview. Any means any interview, whatever, whether any job interview go or any selection interview, this is what it is. So that is what I focused on the next year. Next year, as I told you, I did not give more interviews. I concentrated more on understanding my analytical skills and conversing with people where I was lacking. I was not lacking in terms of knowledge, I was lacking in terms of, you know, putting it forward and in a logical way, this is an analytical way. And that is what I focused upon. When I focused upon that, I think the results were obvious, as I, you know, could see. Again, this is what I am trying to tell you. When I focused upon that one, you know, I did get 206. It's a, you know, the second highest in that particular year. Only one person got 209, so the 206 is the next highest. When you worked so much, you know, that I was expecting around 180, 190. But the examiner liked it in that way, or maybe I had put it in a better way, because of my tension, I could not maybe understand it that better. So it happened that way. So that is what I am trying to tell you. What I did was this one, analyze, and try to see how you are giving answers to questions. Always remember that social traits, you need to be very pleasant in the interview. Everyone will say, be smiling, and so on. I will not say you completely smile, at the same time, don't be very serious in the interview. I told you, don't behave as if you have come to a funeral. Be pleasant. Be pleasant and put your point of view. Always understand, put it yourself in the, you know, in the place of district SP or collector. How will you react if people are coming to you? It's the same reaction that should come in the interview. Of course, do not fake that. Try to practice it, don't fake it in the interview. That looks very artificial and it might be very counterproductive. That's one. So this is the things that you need to understand. Then in the last, towards last part of it, and that's what I didn't happen. Towards the last, I would say, you know, a couple of things, just, you know, remember this. Always remember, interview is different for different people. You might give the same answer for a question. Both of us might give the same answer, but both of us might end up with completely different marks. It is because the context in which you are put in matters more. And finance graduate, MBA, you know, MBA finance graduate giving an answer for NPAs, that is non-performing assets, and let's say BA history graduate giving answers for, you know, non-performing assets, there is a huge difference. So that person can be excused if he makes some silly mistakes in that one, but not an MBA finance guy who is expected to know it much more detail. This is what I understand. So each person is different and each person's context is different. Try to understand that thoroughly, more important. And lastly, I would always, you know, I say only one thing. Prepare originally. Do not look at answers, you know, do not look at shortcuts that you are, you know, going to get on. You know, people have written, everyone has written their own success stories, where I was given, it is their experience. Their experience is different from your experience. Your 25 years were not the same as that person's 25 years, right? Remember this, that 25 years, you think about for your 25 years, you will get a better answer. I always say this one, and remain original. Have that originality in you, keep that for yourself. See, that originality might give you, so my originality in 2016 fetched me only 150, that's fine enough. But then originality doesn't mean that not developing yourself. Originality doesn't mean, just in the name of originality, if you don't even look at what others are doing good, that's again foolish, right? That is naivety. We are not talking about that. You should not be naive. Understand, take the good things from others, but retain your originality. If you give answers with some originality in the interview, I am sure you will end up with much better scores than what you are getting earlier. And if it is your first interview that you are going to appear, you will get very good scores. And more than average score, whatever, you know, maybe around 170 or 180. If the average is 160, you might get some 170 or 180. Remember, it is a competitive examination. It is relative scores that matter. 1 year, you know, you might get 160, but that year average score may be 150. you will have 10 marks more than average score, so you will end up with a good rank. Next year you might get 180, but if the average is 190, you are scoring 10 marks less than the average, you might end up with a bad rank, or of course maybe no rank at all. Okay, with this I would like to close this particular session, and I hope you do, you know, you benefited out of this interview, this particular session. If at all you have any clarifications, you can come back to me on that particular thing. Again, I will be coming back to give you, you know, to clarify your own doubts. Okay, if at all you have anything, let me know on that one. Once again, all the very best to you for your interview preparation. Do well, and may the force be with you. Always that originality, remember that one. Okay, thank you. Thanks a lot. Okay.